he has taken a lot of sessions, even on virtual platforms, wherein he's taking webinars on different perspectives of law. And today's topic on acknowledgement of a liability, and in terms of Section 18 of the Limitation Act, what is the scope, how the legal journey in this respect it has been, especially wherein there are debts, etc., how does it arise? These are the key issues which we keep on looking upon. And who else could take things in a better simplified manner to be understood than Justice K.T. Sankaran? Without taking much time, I would request sir to take things forward. Over to you, sir.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Vigas. Thank you, viewers. Today, we have to deal with the acknowledgement of liability. Acknowledgement of liability takes in a property or right as well as a liability. There may be contractual obligations between the parties. Some of the parties may not be able to complete the promise, or they have undertaken certain promises, but they are not able to fulfill within the timeline. By that time, the limitation may start running and may be over. And if the suit is barred by limitation, nobody is going to pay the money. But at the same time, even without going to the court, the parties can agree very well that their rights or liabilities will continue by just acknowledging the dual relationship of debtor and creditor. And that dual relationship subsists. And they promise to do that. Thereby, the time can be extended any number of times. So say, for example, a negotiable instrument. Normally, the period is 3 years. It is not necessary that on the expiry of 3 years, just before the expiry of 3 years, always the creditor should file a suit. It is not necessary. It is open to the debtor and creditor to agree. And even by the unilateral act of the debtor, the creditor may get time. He need not rush to the court. That happens by the provisions of Section 18 and 19, right with Section 20 of the Limitation Act. Now let us see what are the ingredients of Section 18. 18, certain requirements have to be satisfied so that a fresh period, the net result of acknowledgement is a fresh period of limitation will start. A fresh period of limitation will be computed from the time when the acknowledgement is made. For example, say a promissory note. Just before the expiry of 3 years, 1 day before the expiry of 3 years, fixed for filing a suit under the Limitation Act. An acknowledgement of liability is made by the debtor. The creditor will get a fresh period of 3 years from that date. And again, that process may go on. So it is not the law that whenever a right matures or a liability is there, the parties should rush to the court. And it should always end in litigation. The parties can agree. Now let us see what are the ingredients of Section 18. I will read each word because each word of Section 18 is important. Where before the expiration of the prescribed period for a suit or application, prescribed period is defined in the Limitation Act. it must be before the expiry of the prescribed period. Prescribed period means not the period of limitation. Period of limitation, for example, say a negotiable instrument, 3 years. Prescribed period may be some other date, because several other calculations and computations are to be made under the limitation. What is the last date? The prescribed period ends there. So it is that prescribed period that is being referred to here. Before the expiration of the prescribed period, for what? For a suit or application, not an appeal. Appeal is not provided here. Suit or application. Whenever Limitation Act refers to suit, it refers to suit alone. Three categories of cases are referred to in the Limitation Act: suit, appeal, and applications. So we cannot use it interchangeably. So whenever application is referred to, it means only application. If appeal is to be included, that appeal is to be referred. Of course, interpretation apart. So before the expiration of the prescribed period for a suit or application, in respect of any property or right, an acknowledgement of liability in respect of such property or right has been made. So it must be before the expiration of the prescribed period. After that prescribed period, if an acknowledgement is made, it has no legal validity. That will not create a fresh period of limitation from that date. So it must be before the expiration of the prescribed period. It must be with respect to a property or right. And that acknowledgement of liability is made in respect of such property or right, in writing signed by the party against whom such property or right is claimed. So if A has to file a suit against B, A has got a right to file a suit against B. The acknowledgement has to be made by B. It must be before the prescribed period. It must be in respect of the property or right. It must be in writing and signed by the party against whom such property or right is claimed, that is B, or any person through whom he derives his title or liability, that is predecessor. A fresh period of limitation shall be computed from the time when the acknowledgement was so signed. 2. Where the writing containing the acknowledgement is undated, oral evidence may be given of the time when it was so signed, but subject to the provisions of the Indian Evidence Act, oral evidence of its contents shall not be received. That is clear from section 90 and 92. But subject to the provisions of the Indian Limitation Act, oral evidence of its contents shall not be received. For the purpose of this section, an acknowledgement may be sufficient though it omits to specify the exact nature of the property or right. It is not necessary that the exact nature of the property or right must be acknowledged. See, a money liability is there. A has to get that money from B. A issues a notice to B, say that, yes, as per this document dated so and so, you are liable to pay me rupees 10 lakhs. Please pay it immediately. Otherwise, I'll be constrained to file a suit. The acknowledgement is made. A reply is sent. Dear friend, I acknowledge that I have borrowed money from you and that the money mentioned is due. But at present, I am not having that money. I will pay it later. That will constitute an acknowledgement. Now let us see. Sufficient though it omits to specify the exact nature of the property or right, or avers that the time for payment, delivery, or performance or enjoyment has not yet come, the recipient of the notice, namely the defendant, would be defendant, says, true, I am liable to pay the amount claimed by you, but you had promised to give me time. That time is not over, or there is still time. time for payment delivery has not yet come. That also constitutes an acknowledgement. Or is accompanied by a refusal to pay. B says in the reply notice, it is true that I am liable to pay, but I refuse to pay. I refuse to pay. Even then, if it is before the expiration of the period, and it is with respect to a liability or right, and that admits of the subsisting jural relationship, thereby satisfying the ingredients of Section 18, even a refusal to pay will amount to an acknowledgement. Or is accompanied by a refusal to pay, deliver, perform, or permit to enjoy. Or is coupled with a claim of set off, claim to set off. Or is addressed to a person other than a person entitled to the property or right. Instead of sending the so-called acknowledgement is not addressed to A, but to his friend. Even that is enough. That acknowledgement must be of that liability which B is liable to discharge towards A, or a right in respect of which A has got a right to recover that amount from B. Or is addressed to a person other than the person entitled to the property or right. The word signed means signed either personally or by an agent duly authorized in this behalf. It is clear. An application for execution of the decree or order shall not be deemed to be an application in respect of any property or right. So this acknowledgement of liability is a business which takes place before the decree. Execution is nowhere there. If a decree is passed, the period of limitation is prescribed 12 years normally under Article 136, Article 135, 3 years, where there is no limitation. Injunction like that. All those cases where decree is passed and execution has to be levied, the acknowledgement has nothing to do with the period of limitation for execution. There it is governed by the decree, and the period of limitation as provided the limitation act will apply. Even if the defendant says, say a decree is passed, an execution petition is filed within time. The respondent in the execution petition, namely B, sends a notice to A stating that you have filed execution petition. It is true that I am liable to pay. Please give me some more time. That will not constitute an acknowledgement because it is a liability which was matured into a decree. So explanation C says, an application for execution of a decree or order shall not be deemed to be an application in respect of any property or right. That is made clear. Now, explanation A covers several things. I will put a question now. A sends a notice to B. You have borrowed an amount, say 5 lakhs. From me on such and such date, you are not paid back. Please pay. Otherwise, I will be constrained to file a reply sent by the defendant. It was true that I borrowed money from you, but I have repaid it. Does it constitute an acknowledgement? Answer is no. Because there is no acknowledgement of a subsisting jural relationship of debtor and creditor. In the case of a refusal to pay, which we have seen, B says, I am liable to pay, but I refuse to pay. On the other hand, here in this case, B says, I was liable to pay, but I have paid it, repaid it. Thereby, B asserting that he is no longer a debtor of A. Therefore, there is no subsisting jural relationship to be admitted, in which case there is no acknowledgement. Yes. Now, along with this, we have to also to see Section 19. 19 is just, I am not going to read it, I will explain. Here, when the liability is there, it is admitted, a fresh period is there. where debt or interest on legacy, where a debt is part paid, B is liable to pay rupees 10 lakhs to A as per a document. B pays 1 lakh, makes an acknowledgement there, makes an endorsement there in his handwriting sign. That will constitute acknowledgement and a fresh period of limitation will be available. That is section 19. But that also it must be is made before the expiration of the period by the person liable to pay the debt or legacy or by his agent, a fresh period, provided that in the case of a payment, so and so. So that also the principle is same. There a part payment. There the liability is acknowledged. Then towards that a liability, a part is paid. Fresh period of limitation. Begin to run from that date. Then 20, effect of acknowledgement or payment by another person. Please go through it. It is a long section. Lawful guardian, committee or manager of a person under disability. And please see subsection 2. Nothing in this subsection. A section renders one of several joint contractors, partners, executors, or mortgagees chargeable by reason only of a written acknowledgement signed by or payment made by or by the agent of any other or others. Suppose two persons contracted a debt, B and C. Before the expiration of the period, B acknowledges the debt. That will not bind C. That will bind only B. Unless there is some other relationship which is covered by subsection 3. For the purpose of said sections, an acknowledgement signed or payment made in respect of any liability, so and so, by a limited owner who is governed by Hindu law, shall be a valid acknowledgement against a reversion or succeeding. That takes us to a position of reversion, that is before 1956 Indian Succession Act, before coming into force of section 14 of the 1956 Act. A Hindu widow was having only limited right. She could not encumber it, she could not alienate it, she could possess the property of her deceased husband, enjoy it and appropriate in income towards her maintenance. After her death, it will go to the reversioners, namely the brothers of the husband, not to the legal heirs of the husband, to the reversioners. That is the limited right, limited estate. Where the widow makes an acknowledgement, that will bind the reversioner also. In fact, this has become practically obsolete now because of the particular provision in the Hindu Succession Act. Even now, there may be, for the purpose of this section, where B, where a liability has been incurred by or on behalf of the Hindu undivided family assets, an acknowledgement or payment by the manager of the family shall be deemed to have been made on behalf of the whole family. So even if one person who is a manager acknowledges the liability, that will bind them there. Otherwise, an acknowledgement made by a particular person will bind only him, not others. These are the principles of acknowledgement. So mainly section 18, 19 is some other thing, but that also the principle is acknowledgement. Now we will go to some of the decided cases. So now, acknowledgement must be pleaded. See, I am filing a suit. On the face of the plaint, suit is barred by limitation. On the face of it, I aver in the plaint, the defendant borrowed a sum of rupees 1 lakh from me on 1/1/2017. The suit is filed in 2021. That means more than 3 years over. 3 years expired on 1/1/2020. Suit is filed in 2021. So on the face of the plaint, the suit is barred. There is no other averment regarding any acknowledgement of liability also. There is no other averment by which the period of limitation has got extended. So going by Section 3 of the limitation, the court is bound to dismiss it even though the limitation is not pleaded by the defendant. On the other hand, if the plaintiff relies on an acknowledgement, plaintiff has to plead it in the written state, in the plaint, that before the expiration of the period, the defendant has acknowledged the liability, and therefore, even though 3 years expired, the suit is not barred. Some averment like that. Now, what about the proof of it? Proof of it, that acknowledgement must be produced. In writing, signed. In writing means, does not mean that it must be in the handwriting of the debtor. Writing by somebody, but signed by me, the debtor, that is enough. Or B can write and sign, no harm. But it must be signed or some mark put by the person who is liable. Then only it will constitute an acknowledgement. Or if A himself writes there something on the document saying that the defendant has acknowledged liability, that is not enough. The liability must be acknowledged by the person who is liable. Liable under the property or right, whatever it is, person liable. Now we will see some of the decided cases. Some of the cases belong to some Supreme Court judgments are there. And I will also cite some of the Kerala High Court decisions. Because some other points which are not discussed in the Supreme Court judgments, you will get in the High Court judgments. Other states also, there may be similar decisions that the particular state, person belonging to that particular state may check up, so that it will be handy, useful. First is AER 1991 Kerala 76. Name of the case is Sridevi versus Appu. Para 5. In order to operate as an acknowledgement under Section 18 of the Limitation Act, for the purpose of computing a fresh period of limitation from the date, there must be acknowledgement of a subsisting liability which is not already barred. It is true that the acknowledgement does not create a new right of action, but merely extends the period of limitation. It is not a new right. It is not necessary that the statement should indicate the exact nature of this or the specific character of the liability, but the words used in the statement must relate to a present subsisting liability and indicate the existence of a jural relationship between the parties, such as that of a debtor and creditor, and the intention to admit such jural relationship, even though a promise to pay is not necessary. See, a promise to pay is not necessary. That is covered by Section 25 of the Contract Act. A promise to pay even a barred debt creates a good contract. Even after the period of limitation is over, there can be an agreement between the parties to pay bar debt. That is a fresh contract. But here the contract is the same. Period is extended. How? It must be before the period of limitation. It must be an admission of the jural relationship of debtor and creditor. Then even if there is no promise to pay, that will constitute an acknowledgement. So this is the point which is important in this judgment. It can be by implication also from the nature of the admission and the surrounding circumstances. Can be by implication also. It need not be in express terms. Next is AER. 1991 Supreme Court 720 Narayani versus Fatuma. That is under the Mohammedan law. We have seen section 20. It touches section 20 also. Para 6 and 14. The heirs of a Muslim dying in the state, a Muslim gentleman, he has got a liability. He dies in the state. He has got legal heirs. One of them acknowledges. Whether it will bind others is the question. There is no jural relationship between them, and therefore, there are themselves independent debtors, the heirs of this Muslim gentleman. The debt having been split by operation of law. Inter se, they have no jural relationship of co-debtors or joint debtors so as to fall within the shadow of contractors, partners, executors, or mortgagees, or in a class akin to them. That is referred to in section 20. So these people will not satisfy that definition. They succeed to the estate as tenants in common in specific shares. Even a signed written acknowledgement by the principal or through his agent would bind the principal and not anyone else standing in jural relationship with the principal in accordance with section 20, subsection 2. The Muslim heirs inter se have no such relationship. Next is another Kerala decision by the same judge, by Justice Padmanabhan. There are 4 or 5 judgments by him, all very good. AER 1991 Kerala 83 Craft Center and others. Craft Center and others versus the Koncheri Coir Factory, Conchery, Koncheri Coir Factories. Acknowledgement, if the plaintiff relies on an acknowledgement to save limitation, he should plead and prove the same. There can be no reliance placed on an acknowledgement not pleaded, at least by way of amendment of plea. No oral evidence will be sufficient if the document is not brought before court to save the plaintiff, which ex facie barred by limitation. Getting admission from by the defendant is not sufficient. At the time of cross-examination of the defendant, some admissions may be elicited. Even that is not enough. That is what is held in this decision. Next is AER 1975 Kerala 91 Division Bench. Fatuma Bibi and others versus Raja Krishna Menon and others. Raja Krishna Menon and others. I am citing that the High Court only Kerala because it is not possible to have all the High Court judgments and almost a person from Rajasthan is the decision in Punjab may not be as such binding, but if there is a contrary decision in Rajasthan, that will apply. Therefore, I am only to elucidate the principles I am citing this. You have to check up your own High Court judgments or Supreme Court judgments. And 75 Kerala 91. One of several Mohammedan co-heirs making part payment of debt. Since they succeed to the estate of the deceased in severality, no single and indivisible debt to which the payment by one heir can be relieved. The same thing which is held by the Supreme Court in the other judgment which I said. Next is Ayala, 1991, 1 Kerala, 29. Again by the same judge, Jai Hind Oil Mills versus Kerala Electrical and Allied Engineering Company Limited. Acknowledgement can be proved only by the signed writing and not by parole evidence. It must be proved by signed writing and not by parole evidence. Para 5, if there is an acknowledgement under Section 18, it must be in writing signed before the expiration of the period of limitation. The acknowledgement could be proved only by the signed writing and not by parole evidence. If exclusion of the period is claimed under Section 19 on the basis of payment, it must also be before the expiry of the period of limitation. And the acknowledgement of payment must appear in the handwriting of or in the handwriting in the writing signed by the person making the payment or an authorized agent. It is true that though the payment must be within time, the acknowledgement can be out of time. That is under 19. That is the difference. There is one Supreme Court judge, there is another decision which what is the difference between 18 and 19. I will cite that judge. It can be out of time provided there is a suit. It is true that though payment must be within time, the acknowledgement can be out of time. That is under Section 19. But 18 acknowledgement must be within time. Here 19 stresses on part payment. That is a difference. Proof of acknowledgement by payment could only be by writing outside. The acknowledgement, whether under Section 18 or 19, must be specifically pleaded in the plea and proved by signed writing. No such acknowledgement were pleaded and proved, except in that case. Next is AER 1977, Kerala 132. Parameswaran and others. Parameswaran and others versus Purushottaman and Company and others. But under Section 18, that is a difference between 18 and 19. Section 18 and 19. Difference. There is certainly a difference between 18 and 19. As in the case of an acknowledgement under 18, a payment under 19 is also required to be recorded in writing. But under Section 18, the writing must contain within itself an admission of existing liability. While under 19, it is sufficient if the writing merely records the fact of payment. That is the difference. An acknowledgement under 18 only operates against the person who makes the acknowledgement and those claiming under him. But subject to the provisions of subsection 2 of section 20, a payment under 19 saves limitation against all the persons who are liable for the debt. Paragraph 20 to 32, that discussion goes. Then there is a full bench decision of the Kerala High Court, AER 1995, Kerala. AER 1995, Kerala 78. There, paragraph 1 and 22. Sum and substance of these decisions spell out as to what amounts to an acknowledgement would depend on the factual position spelled out by the case at hand. Illustrative, if there is a dispute as regards the amount, if there is a demand for verification of the accounts, or if there is a contention that the accounts are exaggerated, if the relationship of debtor and creditor is admitted, and even if in the written statement this position is acknowledged, the situation would amount to an acknowledgement. Next is AER 1990, Kerala 271. Savior versus Kashi. There, the acknowledgement was in the written statement in another suit. Whether it can be relied on for the purpose of acknowledgement in the other suit is a question. Acknowledgement was made, see the disputed statement, the or the the statement which is relied on as acknowledgement was made in a written statement filed in a suit. That written statement can be relied on in another suit for the purpose of proving the acknowledgement. This is the point decided. Question whether reliance can be placed on previous suit where there has been an acknowledgement of a payment in the written statement held that the plaintiff could very well rely on the previous suit. Next is AER 1967 Supreme Court. 1967 Supreme Court 935. Tilak Ram and others versus Nathu, NATHU and others. Mere statement expressing jural relationship between the parties does not constitute an acknowledgement. Where the statement is relied on as expressing jural relationship, it must show that it was made with an intention of admitting such jural relationship. Simply stating of jural relationship between these two persons is not enough. Admission of jural relationship must be there, subsisting at the time when it was made. Discussion in paragraph 9 and 10. Paragraph 9, 10, 11 and 12. Very detailed paragraphs. Next is ILR 2005-4 Kerala. 173. Matthew Joseph versus the Deputy Tahsildar. That was a decision by Justice K.S. Radhakrishnan and me. Justice Radhakrishnan retired as a Supreme Court judge. The judgment was written by me. There, the point is this. Paragraph 5, the discussion takes place. A contention was put forward. It was with respect to an acknowledgement. There cannot be any dispute that the acknowledgement was there. In enforcement of that acknowledgement, it was contended that there must be a property which is proceeded in execution. Execution proceedings went on. Then, acknowledgement was imposed. There it is contended that this property which is proceeded with was not available with the debtor at the time when he made the acknowledgement. Whether it is necessary is the question. Nowhere it is else it is decided. Paragraph 5, long paragraph, I will read only the relevant portion. An acknowledgement is in respect of a liability and not in respect of the property which is proceeded against for realization of the debt. A liability could be enforced by resorting to various proceedings known to law. The liability in the present case is one for money due to Canara Bank. By resorting to revenue recovery proceedings, the amount can be recovered either by attachment and sale of mobiles or by attachment and sale of remote properties belonging to the defaulter or by the arrest and detention of the defaulter. The nature of the remedy that could be resorted to has absolutely no relation to the acknowledgement of liability. By acknowledging the liability, a fresh period of limitation shall be computed. The liability could be enforced and the amount recovered within the same period of limitation as computed from the time when the acknowledgement was signed. The availability or otherwise of a particular mode of recovery at the point of time when the acknowledgement was made is not relevant criteria. For example, a person may not be having any more property at the time when the acknowledgement was signed. If he was having mobile properties, the amount could be realized by attachment and sale of mobile properties. If in such a fact situation, the defaulter acquires some immovable properties after the date of acknowledgement, there is nothing wrong or illegal in proceeding against that property for realization. This was revenue recovery proceedings. Next is 2006 4 SEC. 2006 4 SEC. 484. Prabhakaran and others versus M. Azhagiri Pillai. A-Z-H-A-G-I-R-I. Azhagiri Pillai. Very detailed judgment, particularly in paragraph 20 and 21. There, in a document, there is reference to a mortgage. Whether that will amount to admission of that dual relationship so as to attract section 18 is the question. There on facts, it was considered whether this averment of the mortgage deed is sufficient. And on principle, it was held that if it is recited only as a derivation of right, not as acknowledgement, that will not bind the party so as to extend the period of limitation. I'll read a few sentences in paragraph 21. Any statement by either admitting the dual relationship with the other will extend the limitation for a suit by that other against the person acknowledging. It follows that when a mortgagee makes a statement about his right to recover the mortgage amount, such statement impliedly acknowledges the corresponding right of redemption of the mortgagor. Mortgagee says about his right. That is an acknowledgement of liability so far as the mortgagor's right is concerned. This is the point. Further, a statement admitting dual relationship need not refer to or reiterate the rights and obligations flowing therefrom. Where a party to a mortgage, by his statement, admits the existence of mortgage or his rights under the mortgage, he admits all legal incidents of mortgage, including rights and obligations of both parties. That is the mortgagee and mortgagor. This is a judgment by Justice R.B. Ravindran, very detailed as usual. Justice Arijit Pasayat and Justice R.B. Ravindran, judgment by Justice R.B. Paragraph 24. I will read this brief, a short paragraph. We may illustrate as to what is a mere reference or description of the dual relationship and what constitutes an intention to admit the dual relationship. If the relevant portion of the deed of assignment, that is a transfer deed, sought to be relied on as an acknowledgement, merely stated that, quote, X mortgaged the scheduled property in my favor under the deed of usufructuary mortgage, dated so and so, and I hereby assign the said mortgage in your favor. So, in the deed of assignment, there is a reference to a mortgage deed executed by X in favor of the assignor. It will not be an acknowledgement under section 18. This is because it refers to only the dual relationship, but it does not show an intention to admit the dual relationship with the mortgagor or admit his subsisting liability as mortgagee of being redeemed. But the position will be different if the assignment deed further stated the said mortgage is subsisting, or the rights and obligations under the said mortgage are enforceable, or the assignee is entitled to receive the amount advanced under the said mortgage. These are the words, for example. Or the assignee is entitled to all rights and liable for all obligations under the said mortgage. The assignee is entitled to continue in possession until the mortgage is redeemed. Supreme Court quoted it, all these examples. The assignee is entitled to continue in possession until the mortgage is ready. These are the words. Example. The use of any such words would show an intention to admit the jural rules, and therefore the amount to acknowledge. Yes. Next is. That is not available in AER or ILR. Therefore, I am not citing it. It's a high court judgment. But I am not citing it because you will not be able to get it. Next is 1979, AER 1979 Supreme Court, 1937. Valiamma Chambaga Pillai versus Shivathanu Pillai. Case from Kerala. Mere admission of past liability is not sufficient to constitute such an acknowledgement. Paragraph 19. Next, AER 1971 Supreme Court. 2342. Shivlal and others versus Chetram and others. CHETRAM. Chetram and others. It was a suit for redemption. Plaintiff relying on certified copy of a statement to constitute acknowledgement. That a certified copy of that statement is relied on. Copy could not serve as acknowledgement. Is what he said. I cited a Kerala decision also. It must be not by parole evidence. It by producing that document on which the person relies on as an account. Next is AER 1988 Kerala 89. It is again by the same judge, Justice Patna. Bank of India versus James Fernandez. Acknowledgement need not be by hand itself. It can be permitted or it can be permitted or typewritten or by other possible method. In writing signed, writing need not be in the handwriting of the debtor. Paragraph 2 and 3. Solely on the ground that this is what the trial court did. Solely on the ground that the second acknowledgement is not written in the handwriting of the first defendant, though signed by him, the trial court refused to accept it as valid acknowledgement, capable of extending the period of limitation. Suit was dismissed. That was challenged in the High Court. I do not think that such an interpretation is possible from the wording of Section 18. The wording is, has been made in writing sign. It need not necessarily be by the party against whom the property or right is claimed. It is enough if the acknowledgement is by any person, etc., etc. But nowhere in the section it is stated that the writing must be in the hand of the person against whom the property or right is claimed, or by any person through whom he derives the title or liability. In order to give such an interpretation, you will have to read in the section something which is not there. There is nothing in the section to indicate a legislative intent that the acknowledgement must be written in the hand of the maker. Written and signed acknowledgements are insisted only because otherwise it will be a fruitful source of false pleas. In writing sign, why it is insisted is that otherwise fake claims will come. So it must be in writing. It must be signed by the person who admits that liability. Yes. AER 1999 Supreme Court. 99 Supreme Court. 1047. Sampuran Singh versus Niranjan Kaur. And one point decided, it must be made during the subsistence of the period of limitation. Then discussion in paragraph 9. Period of limitation for, that is, particular case facts it is discussed, then it must be before the expiry of the period of limitation. That is the only point he said. Next is AER 2000 Supreme Court 3597. Para 10. It may be noted that for treating a writing signed by the party as an acknowledgement, the person acknowledging must be conscious of his liability and the commitment should be made towards that liability. It need not be specific, but if the necessary facts which constitute the liability are admitted, an acknowledgement may be inferred from such admission. Inference is possible. Yes, these are some of the relevant decisions under Section 18. With this, we'll close the session because...
Yes, sir. So we have received one question. If a director of a company signs on its balance sheet, which acknowledges a debt in the sundry creditors, will it be considered as an acknowledgement of a debt?
That is managing director.
Yes, sir.
Managing director of a company, if he has the authority to do so, that will bind the company.
Just seeing as to whether we have received it on some YouTube. No, sir. So, thank you, friends, for being connected with us. And as usual, Justice K.T. Sankaran has taken us to the legal journey of the acknowledgement of debts. I hope that the doubts, if any, would have been cleared by now. And on Saturday, we would be having an interesting facet on how to read a Bare Act statutes, rules, and understanding them. That is by Mr. Uday Hola, a senior advocate and a former advocate general of Karnataka. So do stay connected with us on Saturday. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay blessed. And thank you, sir, once again, for sharing your deeper knowledge.
Thank you. Saturday subject is excellent.
Yes, sir, we had discussed, if you remember, I told you that this is a topic which everybody wants to understand. What will be the meaning of proviso? What would be the meaning of note? What would be the meaning of notwithstanding that? These are certain issues which...
And I heard of Advocate Holla and big company lawyers, very big.
Sir, so I was sharing with him. He said on an average, I have 30 cases. And I've been told he charges anything running into whooping lakhs per hearing. I said, sir, you should in fact take one session, how to manage the court cases, how to read them, and how to...
I have not seen Mr. Holla. I've been told by some of the judges of the Karnataka state that there any client going to that office will be having free food throughout the year.
Free?
Free food. Morning, lunch, evening, whenever is there is a catering unit also.
Yeah.
The full-fledged office. That is, I have heard. I have not seen.
I have not seen
Mr. Holla also.
So do stay connected. Connect with us on Saturday.
Yes, I will.
We will connect you on a virtual platform at least.
I like.
He has got good fan following. I've seen that a lot of people have sent me the messages. The free webinar or otherwise, people are wanting to join that webinar. And he has done 2-3 webinars with us, and they're doing exceedingly well. And we generally take with him soft skills of advocacy, how to be a good advocate, how to draft, how to read the judgments. We have taken sessions with him on these.
But such people must come to that.
And a lot of associates have also become, have adorned the High Court bench. I think a lot of them are right now also adorning the High Court bench. He has been 4 times Advocate General.
Yes, I did not have the fortune to see him and interact with him.
On Saturday, I will.
Saturday, if possible, I will come. Otherwise, I will go to some other
place. Right, sir. Thank you, sir.
Saturday at what
time? 6 p.m. I will share the invite with you.
Yes. You share the invite. If possible, yes. I will join. Because yes, I also wanted to see Mr. Holla.
Right, sir.
I have heard a lot about you.
No, he is a larger than life image. Yes. Right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.